Very.
Well, good morning. I'd like to welcome you to worship this morning. In the way of announcements, today is Communion Sunday, so I hope you have your communion elements that are located out in the vestibule. Okay. Looking ahead, this Saturday is Vacation Bible School at Fairton, UMC, 9 to 3. Be in prayer for the kids and the help there. Also looking further ahead, August 26th, it's a Friday, Frosty Friday, at 6:30, we'll meet at Frosty's in Cedarville, just for fellowship activity. And looking further ahead, August 28th is our Family Worship Sunday. We're going to be finishing up the Jesus Lead with Paul. Either love him or you hate him, Paul will be the last of our Jesus Lead. Is there any other announcements?
Do they need help with Vacation Bible School?
Not really. Not right now that I know of, no. But thank you for offering. Any other announcements? Did you want to make an announcement about what you're just talking about? Not bringing in stuff?
I think everybody here heard.
Well, if you didn't hear it, some of the stuff that we had in our rummage sale stuff got moldy. So we're worried about making sure we don't bring any mold in. So if you're going to bring something in, make sure you get Jeannie or Sharon to let you in so we can inspect what brings in.
We appreciate the donations, but we lost a lot of stuff.
Right. Any other announcements to be made? Let's take a few moments of silent prayer to prepare us for our communion worship service. Let's pray together. Almighty God, who speaks a word of peace to calm the sea, our caring God who nudges us away from fear towards faith, our ever-present God who fills us with awe but raises many questions without easy answers, open our ears to hear you, open our eyes to see you in our lives, strengthen our hearts for the challenges that lie ahead, and open our ears this hour to hear the word you speak. This we pray in Jesus' name. Please stand if you're able for the call to worship. With friends and strangers, with family and neighbors, we gather.
Come among us, healing God, with that love that never fails.
With faith reaching out to touch, with hearts straining to trust, we hope.
Come among us, friend of the broken, with your compassion, make us whole.
With word and wonder, with silence and song, we wait.
Come among us, dryer of our tears, to lift us to your unity.
All of you. Our first hymn is number 361, Oldie But a Goodie, Rock of Ages. And yes, we're going to sing a cappella today. It'll be okay.
Rock of Ages, clap for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the flood from the curtains I wish be of sin the double cure.
message, I brought in a trophy of mine from 1990. It's been a few years. I was the MVP because I'm not a tournament kind of person or, as you can tell, athlete. But I was the MVP somehow that year for soccer. Have you ever won a trophy?
I did.
What'd you win a trophy for?
I won it for most improved in bowling.
Most improved in bowling, okay. Anybody else win a medal or a trophy? No? It's okay. Can't all be winners. That's what I try to tell people. We don't all get the trophies these days. At least they didn't when I was a kid. Now, when we think of medals, sometimes we think of the Olympics, right? And they have three kinds. They have gold, if you're really good. Silver, you didn't quite make it. But bronze, you're just squeaking in at the end there. Gold, silver, and bronze. And my favorite thing to watch is track and field. And several years ago, when they had the Olympics in Barcelona, Spain, the world saw one of the greatest moments in Olympic history. A young man named Derek Redmond had dreamed all his life of winning a gold medal in the 400 meter. And he worked hard to get there, and his dream was right within reach. He was in the semifinals and was running the race of his life. He could see the finish line was coming up on him. And just ahead as he rounded that final turn, suddenly he felt a sharp pain in his leg. And he fell to the ground with a torn muscle in his right leg. So he struggled with his feet and he hopped. He started hopping towards the finish line. Suddenly a large man from the audience ran out to them, pushed aside the security, and ran to his side. It was his father, Jim Redmond. He said, "You don't have to do this," he told him, and he said, "Yes, I do." And he said, "Well, then we're going to finish this together." And so they did. They stayed in his lane all the way to the end. At first, they just watched him in silence. Then they cheered, and then they wept. And he didn't win the gold, or the silver, or the bronze, but he walked away with that incredible memory of having a loving father. And when he saw him in pain, half leapt out of the seat to help him finish the race. And there's a Bible verse that talks about being surrounded by a crowd of witnesses. Let us run the race that God has set before us. Throw anything aside that keeps you down. Keep your eyes on Jesus. So what's the race that's set before you? For us, it's following the example of Jesus that was set for us and expects us to follow. It's obedience to God's word and being faithful. Does Jesus say, "Follow me"? And life is like a race, and we may struggle, we may break something, we may fall, but we have a great crowd of witnesses, like your church family, and those who have gone before us are cheering us on, even when the pain is too great. We have a Heavenly Father that will come alongside of us and help us finish the race. If we keep our eyes on Him, how can we not help but finish the race? Let's pray. Dear Jesus, sometimes life is difficult. Help us to keep our eyes on you and run the race that is before us. In Jesus' name, amen. Our next hymn is another well-known hymn, so it should be two of them, probably. So I Love to Tell a Story, number 156. And we'll sing as usual, first and last. faith using the Apostles' Creed. It's 881 in our annals. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is sitting at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence you shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Now it's time to share our joys and concerns. Okay, Jeannie.
I'm going to start with our joys.
Okay.
My grandson and his wife are leaving for Aruba tomorrow. They're not taking their children. It's their 8-year anniversary. And I'm asking for travel mercies. Two, I'm on vacation for the next 2 weeks. Terry's gone away.
Oh, that's party at Jeannie's house.
Have travel mercies for him. Now, Friday, I had taken Ruby to a number of errands that she had. She hasn't been really driving, so I taxied. That's how I look forward to it, because then I get out of the house.
Right.
And she decided that she was going to go to the vet's and pick up pills for her dog. She totaled her truck. She hit a pole and she went airbound for 25 feet. You can't even see where she went in the woods.
Mm-hmm.
She's bruised, sore, and upset because she totaled Bill's truck.
Mm-hmm.
But the officers and everybody on call were just so genuine. Nice to her.
Right.
They had her in the ambulance, they kept her there, they got her cooled down, they said they checked her vitals, everything looked good. But the officer, when he was bringing her back over to the van to put her in, and he looked at me and he said, "Do you have Carrie Underwood?" And I thought, either he thinks I'm really young or I'm really old. But he said, "You know the song she sings, God Take the Wheel?"
Mm.
He said, "God had her wheel and he protected her."
Mm.
I thought that was really an awesome statement to make,
right,
from a total stranger. That so keep her in your prayers. She's no good. She's got sore from the seatbelt, the airbag deployed,
right.
But she didn't get any bruising in her face or nothing like that. So, but she said she didn't want to bother me, and I said, you know what, you bother me,
right?
Because I said if I got from the EMT and said your friend was just killed, I said I would have to live with that the rest of my life.
Right.
So I said I'm not yelling at it, but I did scold her, and she said I sound like my Bill looking down yelling at her. So
and she refused to go to the ambulance to the hospital.
And I told her I would get her home and I would check on her, and so she's very stubborn like that.
She's a little embarrassed too, I imagine.
She was more embarrassed by the whole thing, and but other than that, and we're doing a lot of work in the basement, getting that cleaned up, so we're probably going to make it when we get down there, and we're done.
Okay.
But, because if we have the food distribution, like they're saying they're going to give us,
right,
we can't have people coming in from the street looking at our church that way.
Right.
You know, we have to.
I appreciate all your hard work.
Okay. Don't mind. It's me out of the house.
Yep. Sharon?
I have two. Ronnie Padgett passed away yesterday.
Who?
Ronnie Padgett. Wanted to let me know last night. So please keep his family in your prayer. Mm-hmm. Also, Howard and Judy Marshall.
Right.
Howard is in ICU. He has COVID. And
Howard Marshall, and Judy, his wife, had COVID. She also had a heart attack. Sometimes COVID attack does stuff to your heart and all kinds of crazy stuff, so be in prayer for them.
And Ed, do you know how he's doing? Do you have any?
No, I didn't.
Right. Yes, go ahead.
I have three things.
Okay.
Judy Bradway that is on your thing, she is worse, so please keep her in your, she was doing better with cancer than she said last, and she's not doing very well.
Okay.
And I went traveling there, she's for Ray and Mary Lou, and Elvin and his family, they're traveling.
And Ray and Andy.
You said the first one was Cindy Bradway, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Her cancer's gotten worse again.
So her cancer is worse. And pray for those traveling. Ray and Angie and Ray and Mary Lou are traveling.
Yeah, and my son,
Elvin. Oh, your son, Elvin?
Yeah, Elvin. They're going to be dead in weeks for
him. And your grandson is way of traveling, correct? Janie?
Yes.
Grandson.
My grandson, true.
I try to group them together. Okay.
Yes, but I'm sorry. I just want to tell Ruthie, Peter and Paul are doing fine.
Oh, thank you.
Me, Ed, he got up the first day, her benches, she was unable to keep them, so we told her we would take them back. Terry said no, but they're there, so you won that battle.
Yeah. Metrosexual. I mean, they can do like have makeup and then, you know, hair stuff.
I'll have to tell Terry that.
The things you learn in church, right?
That's right.
Male birds can make nests.
The thing is, men aren't happy unless they're covered around hats.
Yeah. So he's got to have to make a nice little nest, build himself something. Okay.
I talked to Philip at the dump yesterday, and he said Shirley Garrison is doing really well.
Oh, good.
I guess the surgery went great.
Good.
So she expected to actually be in church today, so that's a good thing.
Oh, okay.
And Ralph Gale's doing
it. Yeah, Ralphie's doing well too.
Okay.
He's out on a tractor this week.
Well, here.
But I was coming to church.
Okay, well, that's answered your prayer. Continue to pray for Sister Mary. She messaged me, I forget which day this week. She had started feeling bad again, so she tested herself again, and she was positive again. Sometimes you get rebounds after you take that Paxlovid, kind of like President Biden, that he had it, then he was better, and then he got a little bit sick again, and that's why she's not here today. So she's feeling up to it. But continue to pray for her and all the other sisters she lives with so they don't get it either. Anybody else? Anybody else? Yes, go ahead.
Could we pray for some rain for the farmers?
Sure.
Yeah.
It's definitely, they're saying that we're in a drought state, especially in this area. We need.
Kentucky's getting it all.
Yeah, it's like no method to the madness sometimes, it seems. Okay. In prayer for rain for our farmers. Just farmers in general, it's a tough life. Navigating what farming is in 2022, I imagine, is not what it used to be. It's a lot more regulations and different things you got to figure out just to make sure your crops grow. So. Anything else we want to be praying about? We have those that we regularly remember. Josh Wolf, who's serving in the Navy. A list of those with cancer, pray for healing for several people. Pray for Kentucky and the issue of the flooding, and Ukraine, the war.
And I want to make mention, today there's not that many of us here because people are away, but I think we sounded like a lot of people.
Sounded good. We're ready to go on the road, get a bus, and be like the Partridge Family.
Well, Sharon's the driver.
There you go. So I'm not too sure all these accidents we're having. We'll have to have a...
We love that worthy driver.
Have to have a designated driver. All right. Well, let's go to God in prayer this morning. Lord, we're grateful that we get to come to worship together. We're sad that some people are away, but we understand we have family and friends and we need time to rest. So we're grateful that you have given the people the opportunity to go on vacation. We pray that you would give them traveling mercy, especially to Ray and Angie, Ray and Mary Lou, son Alvin, and also the grandson and the wife also. There's a lot of people traveling, Lord, in this time of year, so I pray for protection for them. We'll lift up those we regularly remember, Louise and Shirley, Chase, Jane and Terry, Jason Green, and Turtle. I pray that you continue to heal them or be with them in whatever way that they need you at this moment. For those with cancer, Sherry Fisher Riley, Connie, Jennifer, Stephen Biggins, Baby Lila, Audrey, we pray that you were with them on their journey and that you will bring them healing. We also pray for healing for Kim, Pastor Jack, Tommy Seaton, Ralph Gale, Shirley Garrison, for Craig. We also lift up Pastor Howard and his wife, Judy, that you would bring healing to these. We especially want to thank you for Ralph being so good he could be on the tractor this morning. We also lift up and thank you for Shirley getting through her surgery well. And we pray for healing for all those. I'm glad Craig decided to make it, and he's still here with us. We pray especially, though, for Pastor Howard, Pastor Marshall, that you would bring healing to him and his wife, get them through this, and strengthen them for what lies ahead. We lift up Kentucky and the whole situation over there with the flooding, that you would help those people that need you in this moment, that you would help restore them, and you would restore the country of Ukraine and bring peace there as well. We also want to lift up those that are mourning for the family of Ronnie Padgett, that you would comfort them. Be with Cindy Bradway, whose cancer has gotten worse again. No one wants to hear that. But Lord, we know you walk with her every step of the way, so we pray for you to fill her life with your hope and your love. We're thankful that Ruthie got through this accident okay, that she is bruised her ego a little bit, bruised her body a little as well. So I pray that you would just comfort her and help her to navigate without having her this truck that was so beloved to her. We also want to pray for our farmers. We live in a country, and then we also, all of us, depend on farmers. We pray for rain for them, that you would provide for them to have a great harvest and keep them safe. And hear us now as we pray the prayer you taught your disciples. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Yes, ma'am.
Who's Craig?
Craig is the guy that I was praying for that was depressed.
Okay. I haven't written on my bulletin last week.
Right.
And you mentioned him again, but I didn't put him on the prayer list for some reason.
That's right.
So.
No big deal. He's still here, so I know that he's a little bit better. Because I felt like he was at a point where he was totally ready to give up. He says, if I don't talk to you tomorrow, you know. So that's why I was a little like in tears next week, because he told me that. He said, I'm packing up the car, and but he's still here. I still see him on Facebook, so I'm grateful for that. So make sure you drink your fluids, water, please, or Gatorade or something like that. Actually, not beer, that's what I mean. That would make it worse. So. All right. Today, we're doing the last of our sermon series for celebrating new life today. Today's scripture is from Mark 5, verse 35 to 43. Mark 5, 35 to 43. While he was still speaking, and that's Jesus, while he was still speaking to her, messengers arrived from Jairus' home with the message, your daughter is dead. There is no use troubling the teacher now. But Jesus ignored their comments and said to Jairus, don't be afraid. Trust me. Then Jesus stopped the crowd and wouldn't let anyone go with him except Peter and James and John. And when they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw the commotion and the weeping and the wailing. And he went inside and spoke to the people. Why all this weeping and commotion, he asked. This child isn't dead. She is only asleep. And the crowd laughed at him. But he told them to go outside. And then he took the girl's father and mother and his three disciples into the room where the girl was lying. Holding her hand, he said to her, get up, little girl. And the girl, who was 12 years old, immediately stood up and walked around. Her parents were absolutely overwhelmed. And Jesus commanded them not to tell anyone what had happened. And he told them to give her something to eat. May God bless the reading of his word this morning. Now we tend to imagine new life as being eternal life in heaven, beginning sometime in the future after we die, where everything will be all right, everything will be good. But restricting new life to what happens after we die does not allow us to embrace the new life that God is creating for us here and now. Now, our Bible story may be a difficult one for some people, as not everyone who has faith will experience a healing miracle. We do not all receive new life in that form of miraculous healing, but healing and new life happens in all sorts of different ways. But notice in our story that Jairus continues to have faith even after the worst news has been delivered, that his daughter is now deceased. In the face of this news, Jesus comforts him with these words, do not fear, only believe. And it would seem that Jairus did continue to have faith that Jesus would do something for him. When Jesus arrives at the house, those who are mourning laugh at him when he says that she's only sleeping. And those who don't have faith are removed. He kicks them out. And they do not get to witness firsthand this miracle that Jesus is about to perform. Jesus takes those who are closest to him and those who have hope in his ability. They become the firsthand witnesses to raising of new life. Sometimes our faith allows and helps us to see life in places where without faith, we might not be able to see it or recognize it. In Jesus' time, there was a very different understanding about sickness and sin, in which it was believed that sickness was related to someone had sinned. This would often cause a break in the community, because you know how people are. Jesus' healing miracles were about not just restoring physical health and spiritual, but also welcoming people back into the community, into a right relationship with each other. When Jesus restores this little girl back to life, he's offering her the connection, community, and to belong again. This restoration that Jesus offered is available to us all, that in Christ we're taken out of our sleeping state and offered the opportunity to be able to live and to thrive. Jesus did not just raise people to new life so we can continue on the same old way, the same old same. Jesus raises people to new life so they can thrive, so we can celebrate, so lives are transformed. As we look at our own life situations, there are times when we're at the end of our rope. For one person, your life may become mundane, boring, purposeless, seems. Or there's a loss of health, as in with the girl in our story. And we know many people that have experienced some loss of health in the last few years, maybe even ourselves. We know stuff don't work like it used to. Maybe it's a pain of a broken relationship, friendship lost. Maybe your marriage is just hanging on. For many children, there's confusion of being sent off to that other parent for 2 weeks or three. As for teens and young adults, they have pressures of school, exams, choosing their career and a satisfying job, dating, finding the one for life. You see, in most cases, we may not necessarily fear for the life of a loved one, though if you're a mom, you're always scared of that, I guess. But every one of us has our unique worries and fears. Among other things, what this story says to you and me, I believe anyway, is that Jesus gives us new life. When our hopes and dreams are shattered, when we have to swallow our pride and eat our ego, when we have given up in despair, when our worst fears become reality, when we, like that messenger, say to ourselves, that's not bother Jesus any longer. There's no sense, there's no more hope. It is then that we're open to hear God's grace and compassion. Never mind that messenger, just believe. So let us hear Jesus' word of life. My friend, have faith. Expect the miracles. Brace yourself for the impossible. Expect healing to happen. Open the door because your long-lost child may be coming home. Hear the whisper of life eternal at the open grave of your loved ones. Let us hear the words of Jesus, even in the depths of darkness of a life of sin, saying, take my hand and get up. There's a little touching story of a boy experienced new life as a result of new hope through a teacher. Those teachers out there, I thank you because you do wonderful things. A teacher who was assigned to visit children at a hospital received a call that she had to visit a particular child. She took his name and his room number and was told by the teacher on the other end of the line, we're studying nouns and adverbs in his class, and I'd be grateful if you would help him with his homework so he doesn't fall behind. So when the visiting teacher got to the boy's room, she realized it was located in the burn unit of the hospital. No one had prepared her for that, to find this young man so horribly burned and in great pain. She felt that she just couldn't turn and walk out, because that would be ignorant, so she awkwardly stammered, I'm the hospital teacher, and your teacher sent me to help you with nouns and adverbs. And the next morning, a nurse in the burn unit asked her, what did you do to that boy? Before she could finish, a bunch of apologies, the nurse interrupted her and said, you don't understand. We've been very worried about him, but since you were here yesterday, his whole attitude changed. He's fighting back, he's responding to treatment, as long as he's decided to live. The boy later explained that he completely gave up hope until he saw that teacher. It changed when he came to the realization that they wouldn't send a teacher to work with me on nouns and adverbs if I was a dying boy, would they? There are times when all of us need to be brought back to life. We need to know that the sleepless nights will not last, that the days consumed by despair will become easier again. The world does go on. There are many agents of resurrection active in our lives today. New life comes in quiet ways, usually. Perhaps there is a phrase in a conversation with a friend that all of a sudden opens up a way that wasn't before. There's a relationship maybe broken for years. Somehow, Bonnie has the grace to start to heal. There are resurrection moments when the gift of life comes from the one who speaks your name, when you're sure they have forgotten your name. The one who comes and finds you when you've locked yourself up inside of fear. These glimpses of God's grace are so often so much part of ordinary life, and we might miss them if we're not paying attention. This is the gift of life restored, the gift of Jesus for us. Just as Jesus entered into the room where this lifeless body lay, he comes into our situations, our hopelessness, our despair, and he takes us by the hand and says in a quiet yet convincing voice, "My child, get up. Break free from the chains that hold you captive. Rekindle your love and your commitment to me. Live again." So Jesus raises us back to life. We know this because he's what he's done for us in the past. Remember in your own life, you can think back when you thought you had nothing to live for. Maybe a breakup with a friend or loved one dies. Or other, just life happens. Just remember. And you will see, you will remember that Jesus is the one who took you by the hand and invited you to new life. As we remember God's faithfulness in the past, we will trust that God will help us to find a path around our obstacles, around our pride, around the pressure from our peers, maybe we have a position, our community, whatever the obstacle is. We need to humble ourselves before the Lord of life and plead earnestly for new life in our situation. And we will hear the compassionate words of Jesus. Do not fear, just believe. I don't know about you, but I wonder what else may have taken place in that house after that healing occurred. Mark says that the girl got up right away, walked around, like nothing ever happened. I wonder if the father, who loved his daughter so much that he would ignore all the etiquette of the day, and risked his position in the church to help find this well-known friend of sinners. I wonder why he wouldn't be able to contain his joy. I wonder if in addition to their initial shock, because that would be my first thought, the family didn't organize a big barbecue to celebrate. And I wonder how you and I will respond to Christ's gift of new life. Jesus encouraged Jairus and his family to remember God's gift of life. He instructed them to nurture their child and also their faith. And the same, when Christ brings new life into our situations, we are encouraged to feast in the experience of God's giving, life-giving intervention. We're invited to fill our hearts with the promises of God, grace and forgiveness. We're invited to celebrate, to rejoice, to make life count. The new gift of life we receive in Christ is one in which diversity is celebrated rather than a cause for division. The gift of new life we receive is one of unity, born not from uniformity, but growing together in our faith. The gift of new life we receive in Jesus allows us to inherit, along with Abraham and all of the people of Israel, the promise of the blessing of God that is working in our world today. So let's celebrate new life, because we know God is always with us every step of the way. And we don't have to wait for heaven for new life. New life starts right now. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for us to have new life. We celebrate that with you. Maybe we've forgotten, maybe we've lost sight of the abundant life that you can have for us. We pray that we would have faith, stand up, and walk with you. Your name we pray. Amen.
Today is Communion Sunday, so I ask that you turn in your hymnal, page 12.
Actually, we'll start on 13, actually. Yes, and grab your doodads. Start with a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and our praise.
It is right, and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So take and eat. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of a new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So take and drink. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Now we'll continue to worship the Lord by presenting our tithes and our offerings. Please stand for evil. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise offering that it'll be used for the good of your kingdom. And we send the people off that they will go confident in the knowledge of knowing your love, assured of your healing touch, and emboldened by the power of the Spirit. Amen.
God be with you till we meet again. By his castle's guide uphold you. With his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again.
Good week. Bye.